Hey there, my name is Gary Sims and this is Gary Explains. Now if you're looking to buy a microcontroller for any kind of project you might have in mind, whether that's robotics, sensors, smart home, whatever it may be, you have quite a range of choices out there, and probably the two most popular are the Arduino and all the different boards and ecosystem that it offers, and the Raspberry Pi Pico. Now they are very similar in many senses. They are microcontrollers, you can do digital I.O., you can do analog I.O., but of course there are also some differences. So if you want to find out more about the difference between the Arduino and the Pico and which one's best for you, please let me explain. Now we're going to start with the Arduino because it is the oldest of the two. The Arduino board has kind of been around since about 2005. The first Raspberry Pi, the Raspberry Pi 1, which was not a microcontroller, appeared in 2012, and we didn't get a microcontroller from the Raspberry Pi Foundation until 2021. So a big difference between 2005 and 2021. So obviously the Arduino has quite a head start, so let's start there. Now many of the classic Arduinos use an 8-bit microcontroller from Atmel. It's called the AT Mega, and so it's 8-bit, which means it is a little slower. It means it doesn't offer as many resources in terms of RAM and flash storage. However, there are also a bunch of Arduino boards that are based on Cortex-M microcontrollers from ARM. That's 32-bit, and therefore it tends to also offer more RAM and more flash storage. And I'll talk about some of the differences of those as we go along. Now there are three types of Arduino board. There are the classic Arduino boards, which really is taken from the heritage way back 2005 and onwards. They have a certain type of header layout because there are these things called shields, which are really plug-in modules that go on top. And of course the pin layouts need to be the same. Now most of the classic boards, which you can still buy today, have the Atmel 8-bit microprocessor in it. However, there are one or two that also have Cortex microprocessors. Now after that you have the nano range. So this is much, much different. These are much, much smaller boards and you tend to solder them with the pins going downward so that you can put them into, you know, breadboards and connect them up to bigger circuits, whereas the classic ones were really there and you would kind of connect things to it. So it's either you connect to it or you connect it to something else. So the nano, much smaller, you connect it to something. And most of these use the Cortex microcontroller cores, although there are some Atmel cores in there as well. Now, talking of the Cortex cores, one of the nano boards actually uses a Cortex M0 Plus core from ARM. In fact, it uses two of those cores. I'll just save that bit of information and put it on the shelf because we're going to need to know about that in a few minutes when we get further into the video. And then the third family of Arduino boards are the MKR boards, and these are all based on the Cortex M0 core, but these are designed specifically for offering lots and lots of wireless configurations. So you've got Wi-Fi, you've got Bluetooth, you've got modules with 2G and 3G, you've even got narrowband 4G communication. So if you're looking for something that's going to do wireless communication across all the different types of wireless specifications that are out there, then you would look at one of these MKR boards. And just to round it off for completeness, Arduino do also have a Pro range, which are a whole bunch of different kind of boards which are aimed for industrial stuff, industrial automation, industrial grade boards. And we're not going to cover those because they really are quite a different category. We're talking about the hobbyist, consumer and education boards that you can get from Arduino. Now, when you want to program an Arduino, you use the Arduino IDE. And it's available for the desktop, for Windows, Mac OS, and for Linux. And there's also an online version, so you can actually use it through a web browser. Now, the Arduino IDE provides a language, which they call the Arduino language, which is based on the syntax of C and C++. And by syntax, I mean you need the semicolon at the end, where the equal sign go is the same as in C and C, curly brackets and all that kind of thing. What you do get is actually a whole bunch of function calls and libraries and runtime stuff that are specifically designed for doing microcontroller stuff. So you want to be able to have ways of turning digital pins on or off, reading from them, analog pins, and so on. In fact, the Arduino language is based on another language called wiring. Wiring is a language designed for doing microcontroller stuff, and wiring itself was based on processing, and processing was a language designed to teach coding in the context of visual arts. Now, it's also worth mentioning that three or four boards from Arduino can also be controlled using MicroPython, can be programmed using MicroPython, but they are not very, very boards when you look at the whole context of everything out there. So at the moment, that's still much of a kind of a growth area for Arduino. If you say to most people Arduino, they can talk about the Arduino IDE and the C-like programming language based on wiring. Now, when it comes to price, because that's obviously an important factor when you want to buy particularly more than one board, you want a whole bunch of them for whatever project you're doing, an official Arduino Nano board can set you around 11 euros, is around $13. The Arduino Uno R3 Classic board retails officially for around 20 euros. And then as you go up through the various different boards, you can be paying up to 60 or 70 euros, depending on the particular thing. So for example, if you're doing narrowband IoT, and it's got all that fancy stuff built into it, then you're gonna pay more than that for that than you would just a kind of a more vanilla flavored, you know, microcontroller. Now, the good thing about Arduino is that all of the stuff they produce is open source. Not only is the IDE open source, but also the boards themselves are open source. So all the schematics, everything you need to know is out there. And as a result, there are lots of clone boards that are Arduino compatible. They've basically taken the information from Arduino and they've manufactured themselves. These tend to come out of the big manufacturing factories, you know, kind of in Asia, in China, and that kind of thing. And if you buy a clone board, then you can expect to pay around €6 or €7, $6 or $7 maybe, for one of those boards. But it's not an Arduino original, it's a clone. But in my experience, I've bought a few of those over the years, they work just as you'd expect. Now, just throwing one caveat here when talking about the Arduino and the Pico, and that is these prices I'm talking about are normal price. I'm not talking about if there's been some kind of chip shortage. I'm not talking about if you're trying to find some scalpers who are trying to sell you, you know, a board that should cost $10 and they're trying to sell it to you for $50. I'm just talking about in the normal world, that's the prices you should expect to pay. And as a side to that side, I would say do beware of scalpers, whether that's Raspberry Pis or Nvidia Jetsons, or whether it's, you know, Arduinos. Don't buy from scalpers who are putting the price up. Wait until you can get them through the official distributors, and then you won't have a problem, won't pay over the odds. I've never paid over the odds for a Raspberry Pi or for a Jetson or for an Arduino. I always get them from the official channels, and I get them at the good prices. Now, when of course you're talking about microcontroller, one of the big things is what can it control? It's a microcontroller. And so all of these boards, Pico and Arduino, come with a range of input and outputs that you can then program. So you've got obviously digital inputs and outputs. Is something on or is it off? You can switch it on or you can switch it off. You've got analog inputs and outputs, so, you know, reading a voltage, which is of course good when you're trying to read something from a sensor that gives you back an analog number. And then of course there are interrupts. Now, interrupts are very important when it comes to microcontrollers, because you can, when something happens on a pin, automatically a piece of code will run, and that's very different to if you're doing polling. Now, when you do polling, you have to go around and check to see, is it there? Is the flag set? Is that thing set now? Can I do that thing? It does it automatically. And these are true of both the Arduino and of the Pico. And because you've got these various digital and analog pins, you can then use them to talk to peripherals over some specifically defined interfaces. For example, you've got SPI, the serial peripheral interface, you've got I2C, you've got standard serial, which might be, you know, using a UART, and you've got things like power width modulation, and all of these different ways of talking can all be handled by the Arduino. There are lots of other boards that you can get that are not Arduino compatible, in the sense that they're not even designed to be Arduino compatible. They are microcontrollers, but people have written support libraries so that actually you can still program them using the Arduino IDE. So for example, I do have some videos here on this channel about the blue pill and the black pill. These are these generic ARM Cortex boards, very cheap to buy, relatively easy to program and to use, and some very good people, clever people, have made libraries for these so that you can actually program them from the inside of the Arduino IDE. So really, Arduino, not only does it kind of cover its own stuff and cover, you know, kind of clone stuff, it also covers stuff that isn't really designed to be for Arduino, but people have made the right libraries and the right interfaces so you can actually even use those as an Arduino. So as a summary, the Arduino is mature, it's been around a long time, you've got a big community, you've got a big ecosystem, the boards are readily available both from Arduino itself and from clone manufacturers. There are lots and lots of different libraries out there, lots and lots of different ways of supporting things, and really if it can't talk to an Arduino, then it can't talk to anything. That's almost the kind of position you're in, and there's lots of flexibility in the types of interfaces that you can talk to, analog digital interrupts, PWM, you know, I2C, as I said, all those kind of things. So really, kind of the Arduino is this generalistic, great idea that covers so much in the hobbyist and educational market for doing things with microcontrollers. But then in 2021, we had the advent of the Raspberry Pi Pico. Now, the Raspberry Pi Pico was important for two reasons. One is itself was a microcontroller board, which we'll look at a bit in detail in a moment, that came from the Raspberry Pi Foundation and came with all the support and the backing that you get when you buy a Raspberry Pi kind of product. But also, they built it with their own designed microcontroller chip. Although it uses the Cortex M0 Plus CPU core from ARM, there's quite a few interesting things about that microcontroller that means that actually they decided to sell it to other people. So you can actually just buy the chip if you are a hardware designer, and then you can start building other products. And we'll talk more about some of those products in a minute. But that chip is called the RP2040, RP for Raspberry Pi. The first digit 2 is because it's a dual core. So you've got two Cortex M0 cores. I do have some videos here on this channel about how to get that multitasking working across two cores on a Raspberry Pi Pico. The 0 is there because it is a Cortex M0 core. So if in the future there was a Cortex M3 core, it would be with a 3 in that place, or a 4 or a 7, depending on whatever Cortex core they end up using. The 4 is an indication of how much RAM it's got. It's a 2 to the power of 4 times by 16K, which is actually 256K. This one's got 264K, so it's a kind of a rough indication on how much memory it's got. If you had half of that, it'd be a 2. If you had double that, it would be an 8, and so on. And the last 0 is how much built-in flash is there on the chip itself. Now, on the actual chip, there is no built-in flash, and one of the things the Raspberry Pi Pico board does, as well as adding power, of course, and the clocks, and the support for USB, is it actually adds onboard flash. So the Pico board has got 2 megabytes of flash built into the board. Now, the Pico is programmed differently to the Arduino setup, although there is a caveat to that, which I will mention in a minute. So you use it in one of two ways. The first way is to use MicroPython, and this is dead simple. So if you use an IDE like Thony, that is a Python IDE, literally it will say, oh, I see you've got a Raspberry Pi Pico here. Should I save this Python script onto that and then run it? And you go, yes, please do that. And it just runs. And then you edited it a bit. And when you save it, it goes, I'm saving it back to the Pico. And then it starts running it. So literally all we've got to do to program your Pico is write some Python code, and there are lots of libraries built into MicroPython, a kind of a variant of Python specifically for microcontrollers, for doing all the I/O stuff, just like there's the C stuff inside of the Arduino for doing all the I/O stuff. So again, you can access, you know, the serial port, and you can access the analog pins and the interrupts, and you can access all these things, including the second core, and have the two cores communicating with each other, timers, all this kind of stuff, all built in there to MicroPython. All you've got to do is write some Python, load it onto the board, and it starts working. Now, the second way is to use C and C++. And in this case, it's full C and C++. So it's actually a full C and C++ compiler, GCC from the GNU Foundation. And basically, you're able to compile things directly and do it very low level. In fact, you can program it from a Raspberry Pi over to the Pico, and you get full debugging. You can step through even at assembly level language. And if you've seen my two videos here on Piccolo OS, that was the multitasking OS that I wrote as a demonstration to show you what you can do on a Raspberry Pi Pico if you're using C and kind of writing native code to run directly, the binaries to run directly on top of the Pico. So if you can write a multitasking OS in the C and C++, then you can basically do anything. You can't do that with the Arduino one because it's not that low level, it's much more high level, but you can with the Raspberry Pi Pico. And when it comes to price, of course, the Raspberry Pi Pico just sells for $4 or €4. And that's the price I've paid. I've bought several of them at different times from different places, and that is the price. Again, go back to what I said a moment ago about scalpers and ridiculous prices that you see sometimes. So when you can get hold of them, and where I am at the moment, there's lots of them in stock. If you go to one of the shops, stores, they've got thousands in stock, you can get them. So I just recently bought another two because I wanted to try some other kind of project, and no problem getting them, and that's what they cost. And if we're just talking about the GPIO pins, again, exactly the same as the Arduino, you've got analog and you've got digital and you've got interrupt, and you can use I2C and SPI and the serial port. You can use pulse width modulation. But there's one thing extra you can do on the Raspberry Pi Pico, and that is you can use PIO, programmed input output, or programmable input output. And that's basically, it runs a little program. So there's a little program you can run on just for the I/O controller that can do things at certain times and in certain ways, and that's very good for making sure that the signals are going in a over the simplistic point of view, but they're going up and down when they need to, and that's fully programmable. In fact, you can actually then program serial and I2C and SPI just using that programmable I/O block inside of the chip there. So if you want to interface to something very tricky, then and you want it to be consistent in hardware level, then you can use PIO on the Raspberry Pi Pico. Actually, if you do want some videos about PIO and how it works and what you can do with that, please do let me know in the comments below, and I'll see if there's enough interest and maybe we'll put together a video. Now, if you remember, I said, remember, put that on the shelf, that there's a Cortex M0 Plus dual core version of the Arduino. Well, if you think about it, that's because the dual core M0 Plus version we've got in the Pico is actually, they've taken that RP2040 chip and they've put it into an Arduino. And so because of that, you can actually get an Arduino with the same processor in it as the Raspberry Pi Pico. You program it through the Arduino IDE, but actually it's the same dual core processor, and then you can do everything in that. So you can actually get the best of both worlds by using the Arduino version of the Pico's processor, because you still stay with the Arduino ecosystem, but using the power of that RP2040 processor. And then as a result of that, you can find some libraries that allow you to actually just take a normal Pico and integrate it into the Arduino system. Again, just like you can with the Blue Pill and other boards that are not designed for that, but actually the clever people have made a way to allow it to be integrated. So there you go. So you really, you've got all the options that you could ever possibly want. Okay, so what do we say in conclusion? Well, first of all, Arduino is ubiquitous. It's relatively well priced, particularly if you look at the clone boards. There are lots of sophisticated niche boards available with lots of interesting connectivity on them. If, as I said, the community, the ecosystem is huge and mature, so you can't go wrong, as it were, with choosing the Arduino. However, the Raspberry Pi Pico has this great thing, is that it's coming from the Raspberry Pi Foundation, which of course has proven to be absolutely amazing in the educational market and the maker market with all the Raspberry Pi devices. And I've got lots of videos here on the channel here about the Raspberry Pi reviews, projects, and so on. And now you've got this microcontroller that's got a dual core Cortex M0 Plus processor in it, plus 2 megabytes of flash and all this kind of stuff. So, and it's only €4. So kind of like you say, well, should I buy an Arduino? Should I buy a Pico? Which way do you go? Well, me, I used to just say, well, you get an Arduino. Of course you get an Arduino because everything works with an Arduino. But now, when I recently had to pick some more microcontrollers, I found myself saying, oh, I'm going to get the Pico because it works. It works with MicroPython. It works with a full C++ compiler for it, but it only costs €4 or the equivalent in the local currency. And so I went with the Pico. So what does that mean? Does that mean the Pico is going to knock down the Arduino? Well, they seem to be working together at the moment, because you can still get, as I said, the Arduino with the same processor on it. I think that we're going to see the Pico grow more and more in its popularity, and particularly if the Raspberry Pi Foundation bring out other variations of it. And there are other variations coming out from third parties, as I say, because you've got the Arduino version. There are other ones from Adafruit and so on, and they're starting to do things like add Wi-Fi modules to them and this kind of stuff, so that you're getting more and more sophisticated boards. And obviously you pay more for them because you've got more things on them, but it's in that same ecosystem. Now, I don't think they're going to kind of kill each other. It's not rivalry in that sense, but it does give you and me as consumers the choice. And me personally, the last time I made a choice, which one do I want? I went with the Pico. So that kind of surprised me, which is why I'm actually making this video, because I've discovered that the Pico is sufficiently growing and it's sufficiently supported and it's sufficiently able that actually I find it the better choice. So do tell me in the comments below which one would you prefer. If you were starting a new project tomorrow, which board would you go out and get to start doing that? What experience do you have of both those systems? I'm sure me and other readers of the comments will be interested to hear what you have to say. Okay, that's it. My name's Gary Sims. This is Gary Explains. I really hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please do give it a thumbs up. If you like these kind of videos, why not stick around by subscribing to the channel? Don't forget, you can follow me on Twitter, at Gary Explains, and I also have a monthly newsletter. Go over to GaryExplains.com, type in your email address. You won't get any spam, but you will get that newsletter. Okay, that's it. I'll see you in the next one.